PoPolitickin.com.
Welcome back to PoPolitickin.com. Make sure you subscribe on YouTube, like on Facebook, iTunes, subscribe, all that good stuff. I'm not politicking with my homie Rossi, the SkullKrusher Brown. How you doing?
I'm good, brother. How you doing?
I'm wonderful, man. So I just want to give them a little about your background a little bit. You are a pro wrestler, wrestled for NWA, WCW, Ring of Honor, had the longest title reign with the SkullKrushers for 777 days.
Yeah.
All right. So before we get into all that, the good stuff, man, I just want to, we always like to break it off with an icebreaker, interesting fact about you and me. So I just want to, who's your favorite comedian? Mine is Dave Chappelle.
Oh, man. Does it have to be one? Can it be two?
That's what I was thinking, too. I was like, it's kind of hard, because I was kind of Dave Chappelle and Gavin Hart. So I guess you can name two.
I'm stupid this way, but I always do, like, my favorite white comedian and my favorite black comedian. I just always have since I was a kid. Not even to be, like, racist. It's just, like, two separate categories, because you know, comedy is so vast, and it's comedy can be anything. So there's, you know, who's more funny than who and what and where, you know, and it's all comedy. So I would separate my favorite white comedian from my favorite black comedian. But then there's, you know, people that are in sitcoms that are hilarious, but they don't. They're not in the same category as, like, stand-up comedians. So comedy is just so big. So, yeah, I do have my two categories. My favorite black comedian is Corey Holcomb, man.
Yeah, I like him.
He just has me tripping because...
He wrong, too. He's keeping off change.
Yes, he says stuff that every man wants to say. And no, they... He just has me tripping, and he loves to get heat. He knows how to get heat with women. It's great. And my favorite white comedian is Jim Jefferies, the Australian dude that he played in Legit, and he does a bunch of stand-up specials. He's pretty damn funny also.
Okay. And where's your hometown? Like, where are you from?
I'm from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. I lived there for about 38, 39 years, but now I live out in Arizona.
Okay.
Out in the next sun.
And then can you just go into your background, let us know, like, how you got started in pro wrestling, like, what was your influences?
All right. My influences, well, first, my father used to take me to wrestling when I was a baby, and that's the first thing that I have with anything, so... It was, like, born into me. I knew what I wanted to be when I could barely walk. So my father would take me to wrestling. And at the time, when I was a baby, I lived in the AWA territory, which is the Midwest in Milwaukee. And I remember Black Jack Mulligan and Black Jack Lanza. And those names stuck in my head. And, I would say they were my first influences, and the crazy thing is Barry Windham was another one of my influences later on when I was, you know, 11, 12, 13, 14, but I didn't know that Black Jack Mulligan was his father,
right.
And that just tripped me out that both of those dudes had a major influence on the way I carried myself and the things I did and the things I did in high school to people. and they were father-son, but yeah, that tripped me out. Another one of my influences, man, that's another big thing. Like, my whole personality, everything I do in life, every reaction I give, and it's pro wrestling developed me as a human being. So I'm just like a melting pot of everything I've ever learned and saw and sucked in my body and in my memory from childhood up until, you know, maybe 10, 15 years ago. And I'm just a big melting pot of all of that. So I... man, you know, of course Dusty Rhodes influenced me, but then I used to get in a conflict when he was fighting the Horsemen, because at that time I was like 12 and 13 and I started to like the bad guys, and then I questioned my morality as a human being. Like, why do I like Ric Flair? This is not right, man. I was for real questioning myself, because like I said, wrestling influenced my life. That's what taught me everything. Life is a work. I mean, they manipulated my brain so bad. So I was questioning, like, man, and Nikita Koloff, this dude, he's from Russia, but why should I hate him because he's from Russia? He don't cheat. He just beat people up and beat them.
And then he's not actually even from Russia.
Right. So I'm like, man, that dude is so cool, man. But then I like Sting. I don't want them two to fight each other, but now they got to. It was crazy, man. So many things and people influenced me, and, you know, I went through the era of the All Japan stuff with Kobashi and Stan Hansen and Steve Williams and Terry Gordy and Taue, and man, I love the strong style Japanese wrestling. So everything influenced me, because I didn't do what people do now. Pro wrestling was pro wrestling. It didn't matter that a big fat guy was wrestling another big fat guy, because you wanted to see someone win, but you cared about the, it wasn't the, how do you say, it wasn't the anger, the quality of the match wasn't what was in your mindset when you were watching wrestling, when wrestling was good. It was good versus evil. I want this dude to beat this dude. You didn't care that it was King Kong Bundy versus Uncle Elmer.
Right.
You're not going, that, oh man, I'm not going to watch that match. What can they do? They can't fly around. No, you had an interest. You wanted to see Uncle Elmer somehow beat King Kong Bundy, and it didn't have to be, you know, 800 spots and false finishes, you know. So it had your soul and it had your emotion in it, and it wasn't, you didn't judge matches by match quality. You judge matches by, damn, that dude cheated to beat him, and I knew he had him beat. And you know what I mean? That's how you went into the next week, not saying, oh, man, I hope Adrian Adonis has a great match against Brutus Beefcake next week. No, you say, I want to see Brutus Beefcake whoop Adrian Adonis's ass next week. You didn't say, I hope they have a 5-star classic. I can't wait to see those two go, because they're both great workers.
So why you think it? Why is it like that now?
Because we let the nerds in. That's why. When the standards were lowered, look, man, this is the only thing that nerds can manipulate and change the culture of, because it's a manipulated sport. I'll say forms of mixed martial arts are also manipulated, but at least they keep their stuff in a weight category. You don't hear Conor McGregor talking shit to Brock Lesnar, because he's not going to beat Brock Lesnar in real life. No matter how tough he is, right, Brock will beat his ass. but now you reverse that and say Rey Mysterio on the Big Show, but Rey Mysterio somehow beats the Big Show. That's what's fucked up about wrestling. I'm sorry if I cussed it. I'm not supposed to.
No, you all good, man.
That's what's messed up about wrestling. You just kill every. There is no circumstance where Mayweather should knock out the Big Show. I'm sorry. I don't care if he's a world champion boxer. He's 375 pounds and a foot and a half shorter than you. It ain't possible. In real life, in no other form, except for that which explodes.
Yeah, I always tell. That's why I tell my boy that too, man. That's what like that's messing me up with wrestling, because I'm like, man, like you gotta play into that. It's like if you got like Brock Lesnar and Big Show and these guys, like they shouldn't be losing to them. It's like it's impossible.
No.
Yeah, it makes it like, come on, man, like don't be buying to that shit. I don't like that shit either. I always get mad. They get me mad, like really.
It,
man.
I know. Honestly, just say. Brock Lesnar and Seth Rollins had a street fight. You think Brock Lesnar gonna let Seth Rollins jump off of garbage cans and flip over his back and slide kick his leg and slap his thigh? Or you think Brock just gonna grab him by his throat and just hang him in the air until he just is lifeless and let go and he's done? There's no circumstance where those two should ever wrestle each other. It's just unbelievable. I'm sorry. There is. I don't care if it's Bruce Lee. He shouldn't be fighting Brock Lesnar under any circumstances. That's why there should be divisions. I say there should be heavyweight 220 and above. It don't matter what you weigh after 220. Middleweight 220 down to like 190. And lightweight is 190 and under. Anybody under 190, I don't care. If you're tough enough to survive in that division, you can do so. But nobody can ever go from the lightweight division to wrestle a heavyweight wrestler unless they beat everyone in their division and went through the middleweight division to get to the heavyweight. Because that's the only way you can build a monster that can possibly beat a big heavyweight is by having him go through everyone in two divisions below him, like Conor McGregor's doing. And now, you know, he can go up or down because he's legit. Hmm. But he can't go to heavyweight still because he can't go. He
get
can't
the size.
Exactly.
So I want you to talk about your, I guess they always say break. Like, how did you get, who trained you, and how did you get your break into pro wrestling?
All right. The year was 1989. I was a freshman in high school, and WCW came to Milwaukee. And we were hanging out by the side stage area where the wrestlers peeked through and watched the matches and stuff. So we were standing around, and we were back there. And we were like, ooh, I wish I could help take down that ring. And then the guy heard me. He's like, all right, meet us after the show, and you can help take down. I was like, for real? So there was like six or seven of us, so we all helped take down the ring. So after the show, the dude gave us a $100 bill, which we were fucking poor kids, bro, $100. He's like, all right, go buy yourself some beers, and next time be here at 1 p.m. The day before the show. And we were like, wow, all right, so... You know, the next time, like, three people came. Then the next time, to me and another guy. Then the next time, it was just me. So I would help set up the ring with another guy who was an independent worker, which I didn't know what the hell that was at the time, because I intentionally never wanted to be smartened up to the business, because I wanted to be a wrestler since I was ever born and was conscious of what I was doing. And I prepared myself to get into wrestling thinking it was real, because otherwise, why the hell would I get into something that I knew was bullshit? If I knew pro wrestling would be what it is now, hell no. If I was 19 right now and I decided on a sport to get into, it wouldn't be pro wrestling, because I wouldn't consider it a sport. Right now, I consider it a gymnastic choreographed stunt show. It's not a sport. Not in America, anyway. Not anywhere. When it doesn't matter if you win or lose, and just the quality of the match matters. It's an exhibition of a gymnastics meet where they judge fucking matches or gymnastics routines. They judge them and give them a 9.4, and there goes your 3-star match. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, I I got in the business thinking it was real. And one time we set up the ring and like big Mr. Hughes came in and the big boss man came in and like Ron Simmons and Butch Reed and everybody was laying around in the ring. And I was just standing on the apron. I always minded my business. I was always respectful of the business, except for one time, which I'll tell you if I remember. So nobody ever told me, like, get out of here, kid, run away, or go away. I sat in booking meetings in WCW in hotels where I just sat around with them at the table, and they never said, get out of here, kid, or who the fuck are you, or... I didn't know what I was sitting in on. I didn't know. I was just like, dang, there's Mike Graham, there's Dusty Rhodes, there's Kevin Sullivan, there's Jim Ross. And I'm sitting here at the table with these people, but nobody tells me to beat it. I was poor, man, so I couldn't dress with and wear nice clothes. So I always wear dress clothes because it was cheaper. And, you know, I saw Sting and Lex Luger with the nice slacks and then the cowboy boots and then rayon shirts and all that stuff. And that stuff was cheap to buy. So I would always look presentable. I never looked like a bummy kid. So, you know, it was a lot cheaper to wear that than to wear a pair of Guess jeans or some Versace. I don't know what the name of those, you know. So I always looked presentable. And I sat in on stuff, like I said, I still don't know, and they probably spoke in Kearney the whole time, and I had no idea, but from there, they just started doing stuff to me, like, come here, kid, and then grab me and pick me up for a suplex, and then I would arch my back to, like, go over, because I didn't know if I had a choice or not, and then they'd say, no, straighten your legs and stay straight up, you're going to hurt yourself that way. And then they tell me to exhale when I land, and boom. And then I was like, whoa, what? No, that's not how you do it. You got to, because I thought it was for real, you know. So, and they were like, all right, lock up with me. And I would lock up with them because I wrestled amateur wrestling. And they're like, no, that's not how you lock up. I'm like, that is. That's how my coach taught me to lock up. You do lock up like that. Like, no, you lock up like this. So I'm arguing with them on how to lock up because, again, I'm a teenager, so I know everything. But my coach taught me how to lock up. You're not teaching me that. So anyway, they would show me things and never smart me up. But I never, ever asked was if fake or any. I wanted to so many times, but I never did. So then I used to go on the road with them. I used to travel the whole Midwest down to Louisville, Kentucky, up to Minnesota. And then sometimes they would drop me back off in between in Milwaukee, or sometimes I have to take the Greyhound bus from, like, Indiana or something like that, which was cool, man. It was the most fun. You don't even – I skipped school. I was like a hobo or something. I used to just pack up a garbage bag full of clothes. And I had my Walkman, throw it over my back, get on the city bus, and go to the Mecca. And then I'd ride off with them, and then I'd always get a ride back on a Greyhound. And, you know, I made more money doing that than I did wrestling sometimes out here, which is crazy. But that was a lot of fun. So that's how I got into the business. And when I was 18 or 19, I actually started wrestling. So I've been in the business now for 28 years. That's scary. 28 years now.
And then, like, what are the things that you're most proud of throughout your career? The achievements?
The most proud thing my being myself, man. I've been through a lot, and I know more about myself than I ever have because I had a couple of brain injuries, and which the crazy thing is sometimes that like awakens other parts of your brain, and you just become self-conscious and conscious of so many other things. But my greatest accomplishment, I never did a homosexual act for anyone. I never was approached. I don't know if I was or not, because I couldn't pick up on the cue anyway. So I never had to do that. I never had to compromise my integrity with anything. I never unwillingly did anything in a ring. And I never, ever, ever shortcutted anyone in any match. When you pay, and this is crazy, man. I wrestled in front of two people once. The show was paid for, so I didn't care. And, you know, the promoter said, well, we can give you guys half your money and you don't have to wrestle. Or we can give you all your money and you will do the show for the two people. And I'm like, well, we're going to do the show for the two people, but we'll take half the money. That's cool. I mean, look, man, there's two people here. So the guys were like, all right, let's just do some quick bullshit and get out of here. I was like, hold up. You're not going to cheat those two people that paid to see you just because nobody else showed up. You get your ass out there and you entertain these people. You don't fucking try to shortchange the two people. What did they do to deserve that? And we went out there and we had so much fun. And the whole show was catered to them. It was great. It was great. It was a lot of fun. So, yeah, I never shortchanged anybody. I never sandbagged anybody. I have injured a friend or two, and I do feel bad about that. But I guess my greatest accomplishment, some people might think it's minor to them, but this is me, honestly. As a child, I told myself I wanted to be one half of the NWA World Tag Team Champions. Not the NWA World Champion. I said I wanted to do that after, like, I don't know. Road Warrior Hawk was a big influence on me. So I wanted to be one half of the NWA World Tag Team Champions. And I called my shot as a child. I was probably 10 years old or 11 or 9, something like that. And I did it. And it don't matter how big or small a company was at the time. I did it. So that was probably my greatest accomplishment. And this is another great... We were badass. I'm sorry. We were legit. So some days it was rough for some people that had to wrestle us. And we actually won those belts the first time, or we only won them once, but we won those belts because the guys that we were wrestling couldn't handle taking the beatings night after night from us. And they begged to lose to us because it didn't make sense anymore for them to take these beatings. So we damn near won the things on legitimate reasons because we were bad as fuck. And we just were. And political things messed up what we could have done more outside of the NWA. And that is probably one of the biggest things that hurts me. But I wouldn't be here where I am right now if those things have happened, maybe. So I don't look at life like that anymore. I can't be happier. But yeah, my greatest accomplishment was probably winning the NWA tag team belts.
Yeah, I would say you kind of, I was hearing you when you was talking about, like, the homosexual act, so, like, people have to do that in wrestling?
You don't have to. You could be like me, you don't have to, but...
I didn't know that. I was like, hell.
Only so far you're going to... I'm not saying, I mean, it's not as bad as it was, I don't think. But now in the WWE, there's a publicly traded company, so... I'm sure it's, I don't think it's like that anymore. But Yeah, man, there's places around here, there still are, that are homosexually driven. And, I have no problem with homosexuals. My best friend is a homosexual. I don't know if I bust him out or not. But if not, if so what? But yeah, man, it, like I said, I haven't come across it too much, maybe just because people understood I didn't play that shit. So I'm not offended, even though I'm like, was I ugly to gay people and they didn't want to hit on me?
I was gonna say, cause you had that story. You were saying you had a story about when you did disrespect the business or something. You said you were gonna say it later.
Yeah, man. I was, man, it was right a couple of months after I first started working for WCW, and we went out the back door where the wrestlers go out to the rental cars. So that's when I was just a little smart ass little punk bitch. That was the one time I was ever out of line in pro wrestling, I think. So we were out back, and Tracy Smothers, Steve Armstrong, the Rock and Roll Express, and the Junkyard Dog were walking into a minivan. So I go, that must be the loser mobile. They were the young pistols, man. I hated them. I used to call them the young piss heads because I hated, they were too baby facey bullshit. I hated the young pistols. And Ricky Morton and Robert Gibson, it was like the end of their rope. And they were like doing bullshit matches and jobs. They were probably Richard Morton and something else, I don't know. And Junkyard was, that was in his downtime. But I just couldn't resist the fucking joke because everybody else in all other cars, those were the top guys at the time, like Sting and Luger and the Steiner brothers and Rick Rude and Steve Austin, they were, and they didn't write. So I had to take the shot because I liked the bad guys at the time. I didn't like the good guys. So, and of course, it was real to me. So I got to take my shot. So I'm like, that looks like the loser mobile over there. And then Tracy Smother goes, what? I said, you heard me. You see those belts y'all got around your waist? Later to be known as fanny packs. They all had on the fanny packs and Zubaz. So I said, you see those belts y'all got around the waist? That's the closest y'all gonna ever to get the championships around here.
Wow.
And then so Tracy's mother starts walking toward me like, hit me, I'll sue you. So then the Junkyard Dog was like, I got your mammy in the trunk. And I said, I don't even like my mother, so you ain't offending me. And I told Tracy's mother that story like 20 years later. Yeah, that was the one time I disrespected the businessman, but I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know. I didn't know. The next time I was like, well, they might remember me. I better not say nothing like that no
And then you was talking about you was in WWF for a while. Was it WWF or WWE at the time?
It was still WWF at the time. It was like right before they went publicly traded. Like the same, Kurt Angle started 3 months before I did. And I wrestled Kurt Angle for my tryout match, which was at the Bradley Center in Milwaukee. Sold out. I was part of that, right? But they were chanting my name in that match, which was goddamn amazing to have the goddamn Bradley Center chanting my name. I didn't know half the people knew who the hell I was. And then I find out my father was in the crowd. My brother was in the crowd with a friend of his. My best friend from college was in the crowd. Like, oh, shit, this is crazy. But anyway, I wrestled Kurt Angle. And after the match, they pulled Kurt off to the side, and then they came back, and Terry Taylor was like, we want to offer you a contract. Are you interested in working with us? And I'm like, yeah, man. What? Of course I am. So he was like, all right, we'll FedEx the contracts to you on Tuesday, and then we'll start getting you paid. And he's like, would you like some money tonight? I was like, y'all gonna pay me? Yeah. And I got like $400 on top of it that night. And then, you know, my check was in the fucking mail the next Wednesday. I was like, damn, this is tight. So I worked for them, and it's just crazy. They told me to keep working my independent dates. So I was working my independent dates, and I was supposed to go with Les Thatcher down in Cincinnati. So at the time, Terry Taylor and Bruce Pritchard were both in charge of talent relations, either with developmental talent or all talent. I don't remember, but I think it was all talent. No, I'm sorry. Here's a crazy factoid. I was the first hired developmental wrestler that Terry Taylor ever hired.
Hmm.
So I was like his boy, and Bruce Pritchard and Terry Taylor hated each other. I mean, Terry would call me and he'd tell, man, they hate me up there. They just keep fucking with me. They just keep messing with me. So anyway, he would say, like, I would leave and go to lunch, and then everything I wrote in the computer would be erased, and Bruce just sabotaged me. And, you know, it was deep down dirty shit. So one of my buddies was out in Germany going to college, and I wasn't doing nothing but wrestling my independent dates. And I was supposed to report to Les Thatcher, like, the end of November, I believe. So I was like, Terry, you mind if I go visit my buddy in Germany for a week before I go to report to Cincinnati? He was like, oh, yeah, go ahead. I was like, cool, man. You're going to be here when I get back, right? He's like, where am I going? Of course I'll be here. So I get over there. 3 days into being over there, you know, this is when the internet first came out, man. So they were really behind over in Europe. I read on the internet, Terry Taylor leaves WWF and joins WCW. Man, my stomach just sank down into my asshole, and I was just like, we were getting ready to go eat. I'm like, I don't feel like eating, dog. Just give me some vodka. You know, it's over. I'm like, motherfuck, man. Terry said he wasn't leaving. I jinxed this shit. I set it up with the same. You know, I'm like, fuck. So my stomach is just way at the bottom of my gut. So weeks go by, and I'm like, Les, what's going on, man? He's like, I don't know. You're supposed to come here, but they haven't sent money for you, so I don't want you to come here and then not be able to do anything. And I'm like, yeah, and I don't really want to move there and just have to sit there because I don't know nobody. The crazy thing was Terry hired me and Ronnie Killings. What's his name, Cade?
R-Truth,
yeah. We were supposed to be his Harlem Heat. So we were supposed to be a tag team. But Ronnie is one of the last, or he is the last one of the Crockett's boys. He was trained by the Crockett's. So he had a lot more strength than I did as far as political ties to the WWE. I had nothing but Terry Taylor. He stood up for me all the time. He was the one that believed in me. He's the one that hired me. So he left, and one day, it was a Friday night, me and my girlfriend were getting ready to go grocery shopping. And then the phone rang when I went out the door, so I came back in to answer. That was back before caller ID, all that shit. I answered the phone. Hi, this is Bruce Pritchard from the WWF. How are you? I'm like, I'm good. How are you? He's like, I'm fine. I got some bad news. We're going to have to terminate your contract. We just can't find anything for you. So we're going to pay you for the next 90 days. And, yeah, we're just going to yeah, we can't find anything for you, so take care. And I was like, motherfucker.
Damn.
This motherfucker inspired me. But Terry told me, I said, when I got back home from Germany, I was like, Terry, what the fuck, man? He was like, I had to go home. I needed to be home. You know, WCW, my family's down there. I'm from Georgia. You know, they're based out of there. I was tired of being messed with. I was tired of being lived. I was tired of being fucked with. And I was like, all right, so you know I'm getting fired soon, right? He said, yeah, I'm pretty sure you will be. So he said, when they fire you, just call me, and then we'll bring you down to the power plant, and then we'll sign you, and then you'll just join our developmental system. And I was like, cool. So it was still during my contract. We went down to developmental, to the power plant. It was me and Adam Pierce, who was actually one of the, is he a booker with Next or SmackDown? Or is
he's doing something.
Yeah, so it was actually me and him sent down there. And we were there with a guy named Champagne and a guy named... he's the guy that was in that movie, like Wrestling with Shadows, the black dude with the amateur wrestler, Tony Jones. Yeah. Tony Jones is there. And I can't remember who else was with us. And then there was, on the other side, there was Sean O'Hare, Elix Skipper, Mike Sanders.
That whole Chuck little crew they had.
Chuck Palumbo just started on TV, so he didn't have to do that shit no more. So he just came in and took a nap. The Wall just came in and took a nap. there's a guy that Danny Fakir, he was like 5 feet. I don't know what the fuck they ever saw in him. He was a 5 foot dude. He was probably Middle Eastern, but he looked Asian. I don't know. Anyway, so... these dudes were like Paul Orndorff soldiers, you know. And we're there. This is another great story. So we're there, and Adam Pierce was one of my best friends, or is, or whatever. So we were there, and we go upstairs, and we get dressed, and, you know, they're, like, trying to intimidate us and shit. And I'm like, what the fuck is this? I've been in the business 3 years already. These dudes been training for 3 months, and they gonna, like, talk and treat us like we're the fucking, you know, rookies and bums around here. Fuck this. So we go downstairs and we're doing calisthenics, and we're in the middle of doing like squats or something. And all of a sudden, fucking NBC cameras come rolling in, man. I looked at Adam. I said, dog, we about to be guinea pigs. He's like, what the fuck are you talking about? I said, they just brought cameras in here, bro, to show us getting blown the fuck up so they can show people how tough pro wrestling is and try to fucking punk us out. This is bullshit. So, first thing happens, I'm wearing like an independent wrestling t-shirt, whatever company it was, right? The camera's rolling. Sergeant Buddy Lee Parker is one of the trainers. This little steroided up motherfucking piece of shit, 5'4", never could get over ass, gonna walk up to me, take that shirt off. And I had to look really far down to him, like way down. Man, I ain't taking my shirt off. Take that shirt off. Well, I said, dude, I'm not taking off my shirt. So then he goes and whispers to me, hey, man, I trained Kevin Nash. I trained DDP. I trained the Giant, brother. Just work with me here. I said, no, I'm not working with you. I'm not taking my shirt off. I'm not taking my shirt off. And then he got pissed. So he tried to blow us up with doing us, making us do 700 squats and 8,000 push-ups. I'm like, man, what the fuck is this?
Was he doing it too? Or was they just making y'all do it?
Hell no, he wasn't doing it too.
Oh, so yeah, they on some bullshit.
So, man, I'm like, I'm already ready to go home because I didn't come here to fucking see how many squats and push-ups I could do. If I had a talent to be here, motherfucker, you need to judge and see if I could work or not and send my ass home. Now how many fucking squats I could do.
Right.
So, now they put us in the ring, you know. And they're like, all right, guys, we want to see how many of you guys can amateur wrestle. I wrestle amateur because in high school, so I'm like, all right, this should be fun. So we get down there, and they put me with motherfucking, here's another part of this. So everybody's working everybody, and they're having fun doing little amateur wrestling matches. So now Buddy Lee Parker, punk ass, gonna match me up with Sean O'Hare. Now, Sean O'Hare is a legit MMA fighter. This was before MMA wasn't even in wrestling, dude. There was no such thing as tapping out or none of that shit. So we go in there, and we lock up, and we go, and I don't know who got a takedown. Maybe he did, maybe I did. I don't know. So we're on the ground. He goes for my ankle. I'm like, all right, he's going to give me an ankle pick. That's fine. When he does that, I'll do this, and I'll counter it. Next thing you know, this motherfucker twisting on my ankle, doing some... I'm like, what the fuck is that? And I slapped the mat, like, what the fuck? This ain't wrestling. What the fuck are y'all doing? And then they just look like, I'm like, they like, you want to try it again? I'm like, yeah, fuck it. Let's go. So then we go again, and he's putting me in these joint locks and shit and popping my arms and my eat. Man, I was like, this is straight bullshit, man. I didn't come here for this shit. This ain't even... It's not wrestling, it's not amateur wrestling, pro wrestling, lucha libre, nothing. It was fucking MMA. Bitch, I didn't come here to see if I was an MMA fighter. So I'm like, Adam, this is straight bullshit, man. I didn't come here for this shit. So Adam goes in to break the tension. He's like, I'll wrestle him. So Adam comes out to wrestle him, and the match starts, and Adam just, as soon as he touches me, drops to the ground and says, I tap out, and then everybody laughs, and then that breaks the tension. But it was just showing what kind of bitches they were, dude. They were like little high school jocks, and I always hated fucking high school jocks. They just annoyed the shit out of me. I was an athlete, but I had friends that were nerds and that smoked weed and that played hacky sack and that played football, they played violin. I wasn't just a stupid jock, and I just hated that jock mentality, bro. So that soured me, and that wasn't even half of it. They matched me up with that Danny Fakir guy, and I'm 6'4", and he's 5'2", maybe. What kind of match are we going to have that's competitive and interesting? And then he's only been wrestling or training for 2 months on top of it. It was horrible. It was like I was sabotaged. So Elix Skipper was working a small guy. And we had to watch all the matches. And this really pissed me off. So the match comes on. And Elix's like, hey, boss, you got to watch this match. So the match starts. And Elix's like, shoot kicks the guy in the ribs. Kicks him in the face, punches him in the ribs, like, ooh, ooh, look at that. Ooh, I fucked him up, boss. Look at this one right here. And he's just, they're not working a match. He's taking liberties on the guy that came here to see if he had the talent to get a contract, and you just fucking shooting on him because he can't do nothing back to you because you got a contract and he don't. It was bullshit. It was absolute bullshit. So I was like, I'm not coming back here tomorrow, dude. And then Pierce was like, all right, let's go. So we left the day early. And we get home, and Terry Taylor calls. He's like, hey, where'd you guys go? I was like, dude, that was bullshit what you sent us to. So he goes, what happened? We told him what happened. Why didn't you tell me? Why should we have to tell you something like this, man? This is not how this shit goes, man. I didn't come here for this. And, yeah, so Tony Jones called us and told us, hey, man, I saw you, you guys had contracts in the office. I didn't know why you left. I was like, ah, oh, motherfucker, that's only fitting. So that was my brief encounter with WCW. And then the crazy thing was, so that was like Monday, Tuesday. We left Wednesday. I came home Thursday. I was hurting from wrestling fucking Sean O'Hare. Friday, I woke up to go lift weights and play basketball. And on the way to basketball, I was in a car accident and I broke my neck. So after that, yeah, all contract shit was done for the rest of my life with that, besides my Ring of Honor contract. But, yeah, so that was like a crazy point in my life that whole week. Yeah, I busted my neck and it sidelined me for only 11 months. Because yeah, I'm stubborn as hell.
I was going to ask you, like, far as, like, how many injuries are you dealing with? Like, is, you know, like, the movie The Wrestler, is that, like, kind of real or not really?
Let me just say this. The movie The Wrestler is almost not real enough. It's even worse than that, man. It truly is. I don't know if, see, like, this generation of wrestlers, I think a lot of them live with their mamas or something, so they don't have bills, and they just do it for fun on the weekends and not really trying to. That's how I feel. But people of the era of The Wrestler, when they were really on the road, and if they didn't fucking wrestle, they didn't eat, and they became homeless, and they lost their wives from being on the road and their families from never being home. That stuff is real, and hitting rock bottom and living in a trailer park, maybe. Yeah, man, that's real stuff. I just didn't think it was real enough. The only thing that wouldn't have ever happened was the promoter wouldn't send your money to the hospital. He would just skip town and I'd pay you. That was unrealistic. But other than that, yeah, man, that movie was... It had my heart a couple of times. I haven't watched it since it first came out, but, man, it had my heart when I did watch it because I could relate to a lot of that stuff.
And what advice would you give to anybody that wanted to get into the wrestling business?
Don't gossip. You have to advertise yourself because nobody else is going to do it. I made a major mistake when I was younger because back then there wasn't that many independent wrestling companies anyway. I thought I was doing myself, not myself, the people I worked for a favor by staying loyal to them and not going out to all these other companies, which in turn was I was hurting myself because I was limiting my exposure. So you have to wrestle in different places. You can't just stay in one place. You learn so many different things going to different parts of the country. And be prepared to lose money. It's a less than a 1% shot, bro. It really is. And I don't know the formula now because I'm a big guy, so I'm obsolete. I know it attracts a crowd. I know it sells tickets. But I don't know how to create internet buzz, so I'm worthless. So I don't know what the new formula is for wrestling because it's not attracting new customers. It's catering to a little minority part of the fans, which are the smart fans. And you see with the decreased ratings what smart fans actually do for you. They don't do shit for you. They don't buy your merchandise. And they just critique everything you do all day. So you got what you got. But if you put some larger than life guys out there killing those little guys and making it look legit again, you can get children back into it.
You were saying you don't really watch wrestling no more, right?
No. It's the reality is it's just not there. I never watched wrestling to see Captain America fight Iceman. that's a dueling battle. You want to see fun in that. No, I watch wrestling to see a dude beat another dude, not see how cool the match was. So it's gone. That's what the attraction is gone for me. It's gone for my generation. And nothing can grab my heart because I know it's bullshit.
All right. And I said, we're about to wrap it up, but I had one more question I forgot to ask you about. So when did you realize, because you were saying, like, you got into the business thinking it was real. So when was the moment that you realized, like, it wasn't, like, real? When did you realize that? Like, when was that? Like, this might, because you said you didn't never ask nobody, so when did you find that out?
When I would start to travel with them, because one of the guys that I help set up the ring with, he would do shows for the, like, if a guy was stranded or missing, he would fill in. And, you know, he would say, oh, man, I bumped my ass off tonight. And I was like, you did that to yourself on purpose? What the fuck? No way. And then he started showing me what taking a bump was. So they were teaching me it as to protect myself. But when I learned it was... When I learned it wasn't was when I actually went to a dude named Tom Rocky Stone's camp in Wisconsin. I went there with my friends. I was already in the business better than all of them because I was with WCW doing the traveling, but I needed somewhere to train. And the dude was telling me, oh, I need $1,200 and I need half up front or you got to leave now. So they made me leave. But a buddy gave me this paper and it was called a theory sheet. And it was the 7 steps to a match. When I read that, I started replaying matches in my head, and I was like, oh, that's how this works. So I took that stuff, and I started watching people bump in slow motion on the VCR and see how they protected themselves. And I started going to my couch and laying backwards and falling on the floor taking bumps. And that's how I learned how to bump, just falling back on the floor until I didn't hit my head no more. Yeah, my bumps I used to watch Chris Benoit bump when he was in Japan, Pez Wiley bump because he took that really nice high bump, and then somebody like Bret Hart bump. And I just saw that there are different kinds of bumps, and then I saw, you know, it told you the steps of the match, how, you know, matches start hot, you know, some matches have to start, establish a baby face and a heel, and that's what I learned. Yep, that's it.
So what would you like to say to your fans, people that have been supporting your career so far?
All three of you, I love y'all.
I can tell on your Facebook, see, like, you got a lot of interaction with people. See, like, people always comment on you through your Facebook and everything.
Yeah, that's true. I'd like to say thank you. And every one of you knew that I was probably the baddest dude in the locker room, whatever show I was ever on. If I won or lost, y'all know in real life who would have really won if I really fought, who I was really fighting. So, I'm legit. Most of these motherfuckers ain't no more, which hurts my heart because the business is not protected anymore, which would have preserved our legacy and our ability to draw. But we let in the nerds, they took over, and this is what we have. The guys that are doing the flippity flop should be managers or referees taking crazy bumps. They should never be wrestlers. Sorry, that's just the way it is. Or you stay in your own division. I'm just all about being real. And my gimmick was me, and I'm my gimmick. And I'm a skull crusher. I do what I want. I try to be good to people, but don't fuck with me because then you got trouble. So, I love y'all. Thank you. Thank you, Chris. And that's about it.